It turns out, and there's now quite a history of this, relatively recently, people have found that there are a lot of species who can do number tasks. By number tasks, I mean tasks which depend upon understanding the number of objects in a display, or what we would call numerosity. So you have to be very careful here, because you can't talk to other species, and they can't talk to you, so you can't explain to them what aspects of the stimulus you want them to respond to, but you have to design the stimuli rather carefully, so that the critical aspect of the stimuli is the numerosity of objects. Actually, before the Second World War, a brilliant German ethologist called Otto Kurler had shown that corvids, crows, jackdaws and so on, had quite a good number sense, that they could match to sample numbers up to about 7. So he'd show them a sample of black blobs, and then they had to select one of a 2 or 3 objects which had the same number of blobs. The blobs would be arranged differently. If they got it right, they got rewarded. If they got it wrong, they didn't. And they were pretty good at this, these corvids. Since then, since the 30s, there's been a kind of a hiatus in research on animal numerical cognition. But since the 90s, it's really started to take off again. And we now know that the whole range of different animals can do this, both in the wild and in laboratories, particularly in laboratories. We were interested in the counting abilities of fish. Now, small fish often swim in shoals. And if they are in a shoal, there's a smaller risk of predation than if they're by themselves. And if they're in a bigger shoal, they've got a smaller risk of predation than if they're in a smaller shoal.
Safety in numbers.
Safety in numbers, exactly. So you can use this natural behaviour of these small fish and test it in the laboratory. So you can put them in a transparent tank with a few fish on this side and a few more fish on the other side, and you see which side they swim to. It's been shown, not by me, but by my collaborators, that they will swim to the shoal of the side of the tank with more fish in it. What we were interested to do in a paper we published this year was to see whether they had a difference between small number perception and large number perception. So in humans, what happens is that if you have to compare 4 versus 3, 4 versus 2, 4 versus 1, 3 versus 2, this is all equally easy. It doesn't depend on the ratio of one number to the other. So 4 against 1 is just as easy as 4 against 3. However, once you get larger numbers, let's say 8 against 7 or 8 against 5, then there's a ratio effect. That is, the bigger the difference between those two numbers, the easier it is. The question is, would this be true of guppies, which are a small fish about that big, relatively small brain? And the answer was yes, that these small fish didn't show a ratio effect when you asked them to compare 4 versus 1 compared to 4 versus 3, but for larger numbers, they did show a ratio effect, which suggests that, like us, they have these two systems, a small number system and a larger number system. And we thought this was really quite an intriguing result.
I can imagine someone at home thinking, well, surely the fish just looks at two different groups of fish, or shoals of fish, and can just measure which one's bigger, which one takes up more volume and swims towards that. And it hasn't used any number sense there. It's just used an understanding of how big something is. How was the experiments that you've been involved with getting around that?
Well, it's very difficult to control, because not only are there more fish over here, they're of course swimming around, and you could have fewer fish over there and they're swimming around. So it's really quite difficult for the subject fish to be able to make an estimate, but even though they do it actually rather well. How do we know that they're enumerating the fish this side versus that side? Well, there are ways in which you can manipulate the amount of fishness on this side and the amount of fishness on that side. For example, by putting slightly larger fish on this side to balance the number of fish on that side. That creates some problems because of fish psychology, which I'm not an expert in. Some fish prefer to swim in shoals with larger fish And so, you know, that creates complications. However, my collaborators have done a nice training experiment in which the fish doesn't have to choose between two shoals. It has to select a gate into another tank to join its friends, and above the gate will be a number of blobs, and the fish has to choose the right number of blobs. It will have had a training session in which a certain number of blobs would be rewarded and a different number of blobs would not. Let's say three is rewarded, two is not rewarded. In the test, there'll be different blobs, but there'll be threeness and twoness, so but different arrangements of threeness and twoness. And the fish can learn this, actually can learn it quite well. So there's now quite good evidence that the fish can respond to number. But of course, they might also, in the wild, be responding to other cues, like the amount of fishiness in the neighborhood. And of course, these are typically correlated with the number. So you want to try and tease them apart experimentally. But in real life, of course, they tend to go together.
How does understanding the mathematical cognition or the number cognition of guppies help anything? Why have you got an interest in this?
Well, we want to know what kinds of capacities the human brain inherits.